Cheryl will probably be really doing that. Mark may make himself scarce, but it's at the Leventhal's home here in Franklin, right off of the queue. And ladies, if you'd like to go to that, it might be good to give Cheryl a heads up just so we get a head count. And also, if you'd like to bring an appetizer or a dessert, it's not a dinner per se, but if you want to bring an appetizer or dessert, something just to share with everybody, you guys can all just enjoy a great time of fellowship this Friday night. And then Saturday morning, guys, we'll have our men's breakfast and devotional. That's at the Cracker Barrel right over on Mallory there, and that's at 8 o'clock in the morning. And for those of you that are thinking about coming but you're not sure how that affects your day, we're usually done by about 9:30 or so, so we'll try not to take your Saturday away from you. But we'll be there from 8 o'clock, and we'll meet for breakfast. And just that's always a really neat time. So, and then you might mark your calendars for December 24th. If you've been with us for any length of time, you know, we don't do a Christmas Day service. I do like to just leave that day free so you all can be with your families and do your, you know, just stuff together and stuff. So we do Christmas Eve service, and this year we'll be right here. And it's going to be on the 24th at 6 o'clock. Your bulletins say 6:30. That was a typo on my part. I apologize for that. It's actually 6 o'clock. And afterward, because we are Calvary Chapel, we're going to have just some fellowship and finger foods afterwards and stuff. So we invite you to stick around and just eat with your fingers. So, and then beyond that, I just invite you as always to check out the website for anything that's going on our Facebook page or any of those kinds of things. This morning, if you would, why don't you stand with me? We're going to read from Psalm 30. It's up on the screen here if you'd like to follow along. We want to read it out loud together. This is Psalm 30, verses 1 through 5, as we begin our time of worshiping the Lord together. So let's read this out loud together, starting in verse 1. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up, and have not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, his saints, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Father, we thank you so much for your graciousness toward us. We thank you, Lord, that even as we read a passage like this and we realize that it is the all-sufficient God who is being called to and ultimately is the answer to this prayer, that we too can come to and know that you are an all-sufficient Father, a God who loves us and has our every need and your careful attention. And Lord, you never overlook anything in our lives. So we just thank you for the comfort that brings. And we just want to worship you for things like this and many other things that no doubt each one of us, if given time, could express if we just lined up to just share about your goodness. So we thank you and pray that you help us to think on these things as we exalt your holy name, as we just lift you up and just praise you with all of our hearts, mind, soul, and strength. So we thank you for this time and pray that you be blessed and glorified as we sing now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thrown in the Father's love. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name. You overcame, we will overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.
Thank you.
can't separate. Even if I ran away, 'cause your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day, and your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. Rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails. The wind is strong and the water's deep, but I'm not alone here in these open seas, 'cause your love never fails. The chasm is far too wide. Never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages, and your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails. Together for my good. Yes, you make all things work together for my good. Yes, you make all things work together for my good. Yes, you make all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages, and your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails. And you stay the same through the ages, and your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails, never fails. 'Cause you make all things work together for my good.
Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flow be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure.
Filthy and foul, coming to that fountain, Lord, we walked away clean. And we thank you for what you've done for us. And we pray that today, as we spend this time in your word and in fellowship together, that, Lord, we would know you better when we leave this place than we did when we came in. We pray that you'd have your way in our hearts and in our minds. Teach us, guide us, make us more like Jesus, as tall of an order as that is. We ask you to work that out in us, Father, as we spend this time being washed by your word. So thank you. I pray that your Holy Spirit would move freely in this place and find here no opposition in our hearts to the work that you want to do. So we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, good morning once again. Why don't you take a moment, walk around, say hi to someone around you.
Good morning. Good to see you.
I don't know what it is. Was it in there?
There's extras.
It's missing, but there were a few extras.
Okay.
Is that
a pivot on
there?
It's come up on the last one.
Really?
And I wonder if I couldn't have this in the way. It wasn't during service. It was after.
Okay. Well, this is going on. So okay.
Maybe inhale it.
That's like my feeling. Just sitting in my lobby.
Say peas or something like that.
Good morning again. Oh, hey, Lord did this, thank you. Yay. About Hall's cough drops. Thank you. There you go. You're warm. You're great, man. It's like a cup of cold water. Man. That's awesome. Okay. That's right. Today I'll pay for it. Okay. Well, we're going to continue today in the book of Colossians. So if you want to turn there to chapter 1. Does anybody need a Bible? If so, good to see you. If not, then okay, so we're in Colossians chapter 1. A couple weeks ago, we started this book looking at a new series that we started going through the letters, Paul's letters to the Colossians and the Ephesians. We're going to do that back to back because really they form two sides of a coin. Colossians speaks about the Christ of the church, whereas Ephesians really focuses more on the church of Christ. Colossians, much like Romans, but in a much shorter form, is an extremely lofty book. It portrays Christ in very lofty terms. It expresses him, and we'll see this today, where it demonstrates, where Paul speaks about who Christ is in again, very lofty terms. There's no mistaking who Paul understands Jesus to be, and his love for him, his worship of him. The letter to the Ephesians will focus on what does it look like when a redeemed group of people live out in their lives what it means to be part of Christ's body. And as we'll see today, as Christ is the head of the church, the body follows the lead of the head. And so Ephesians expresses what that looks like in flesh and blood. So, but in Colossians, and I wanted to start and do it in that order because I want us to get a picture of Jesus before we begin to look at what the church is like. Paul, again, as we begun to look at the letter, has begun to explain to us the nature of Christ. And we're going to see more of that as we continue this morning. So we finished with verse 11 a couple of weeks ago. We're going to start in verse 11 here this morning. So Colossians chapter 1, starting in verse 11. May you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Now, verses 9 through 11, where we left off last time, Paul had prayed for them, the believers in Colossae, and ultimately Laodicea, and we saw that last time. This letter will be read to that church as well, that group of believers. But Paul's desire for them was that they would be filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual understanding. Now, it's important for us to understand the will of God, but we're going to move now even deeper because it's important even more so that we know him whose will we are seeking. It's not just about the things that we do in response to what Jesus says, but it's also our knowledge of him personally that finds even deeper meaning and importance in our lives. It is not just that we know about him, but that we know him. And we can never emphasize that enough.
It's essential to us. So verses 11 through 14, Paul begins now to speak about the preeminence of Christ in terms of our salvation. And this theme will find itself appearing throughout the book, but we see it here emerging. And notice here what Paul has to say as he talks about his desire for them to be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you. Okay? Now, this is all through Christ. He has done these things through Jesus. But look at what Jesus has accomplished for us and what the Father has ultimately done for us through him. First off, he has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. What does it mean that he qualified us, except that we had at one time been disqualified, that we were unqualified, that we did not deserve, we did not belong, to us did not belong any such inheritance as Paul is beginning to allude to. But now he has qualified us to partake. So let's talk about qualifying first before we even talk about the inheritances. To not qualify for something means you don't have what it takes to be that or to have that. I remember in high school, I ended up trying out for the baseball team because I just loved playing baseball, but I didn't make it. So I went out for tennis and I made tennis. Now I love playing tennis, but it was kind of like the also-ran in my mind at the time. But I didn't make the baseball team. I wasn't qualified. I thought I was, but as it turned out, there were players that were better than I was that filled the spots that I felt like I was qualified to play. It's a rude awakening to find out that you're not qualified for something. Probably any one of us, if not all of us, at some time or another have wanted to get a job somewhere, but found out we were not qualified for that job. You know, I remember back when I was a kid, I wanted to be in the FBI. But, you know, there's no way. But there are things you're just not qualified for, you know. I can't shoot straight. I think you need to have better vision than I have. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that just doesn't work. And so, but, you know, it's when you think that you qualify for something, but then you slam head on into the reality that you don't, it can be a very rude awakening. Imagine being so self-deluded that one day you were to find yourself standing before the Lord and in that moment finding out that you were not qualified to enter into his kingdom. That is the reality that we all faced. And not a one of us, short of Christ, would not have experienced such a thing. But now Jesus has qualified us. How did he do that? He, being God, came into this world, took our sins upon himself, and having paid for them through the blood of his cross, again, Paul will speak to this, he then stands before the Father as our advocate, the one who has taken our sins upon himself. We're qualified because he has qualified us. He has made us qualified to inherit such a thing. And so it's only because of him. Now, what is that inheritance of the saints in light? I would suggest that it's twofold, and it is rooted in the idea of eternal life. Aionia Zoe is the Greek there. The idea there of a life that is eternal, and it speaks not only of a length of time, but also of a quality. The idea that is a different kind of a life. Eternal life is something that, technically speaking, every human being experiences. But not everybody experiences eternal life the same way, do they? And that's true of both eternity and time. Every human being is an eternal being. Everyone who has ever been conceived spends eternity in one of two places. Short of being qualified by Christ, hell is the destination of all of those who have ever been conceived in this earth. Why? Because we're born in sin. It's what separates us. It's what disqualifies us. But not only that, but eternal life doesn't just speak of simply having heaven to look forward to, as incredible and awesome and, frankly, as sufficient as that would be. But eternal life also speaks of the kind of life that we live. Eternal life affects us today. As believers, if we live with the perspective of eternity, it changes how we view time. We live differently today because we know that we're going to live in heaven forever. When Jesus speaks he gives a parable speaking about the idea of hearing the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant," when you stand before the master one day. That implies that some good and faithful things have been done before you go there. But that kind of a thing is not simply the working up of our desire to earn something. As Christians, we know that we're disqualified short of Christ. Our lives are a response to what Jesus has done. Understanding grace truly means that we are living in response, not to earn, but to respond to what has been earned on our behalf. Nobody who understands grace doesn't want to live in such a way. If we understand grace, we know the high cost that it came at. God lavishes it freely upon us, but it isn't free. It came at the price of his own son on the cross. A horrifying thought, a high cost. There have been those over the years that have tried to make it sound like the cross sanctifies the ego trip. The cross shows you how much you're worth. After all, think of what Jesus was willing to give up for you. Think of what the Father was willing to pay for you, how valuable you must be. No. Yes, you are valuable to him, but it's not because you and I are innately valuable. It is because he has simply put value upon us. We didn't come into this world with anything to bring to the table, folks. There's nothing that God looked at and says, I think I want that guy on my team. Never happened. How many of you have ever driven down the road on a stormy day and seen a wet, sopping, ugly, mangy mud on the side of the road and had compassion on it? The compassion that you and I felt for that animal doesn't begin to touch on the condescension that it took for God to show that kind of compassion upon us. He has given us value. There's no value in that mud on the side of the road except that we value and we feel bad for it. But the mud's not thinking, boy, I sure deserve better than this. We often do, but we don't. When we understand that, it affects the way we live our lives. Lord, if you are willing to save a wretch like me, I am willing to live for a God like you. And that's what eternal life is about, on this side of the threshold. So this is something that he has qualified us to be partakers of, inheritors of. We are now partakers, and we're able to share now in the inheritance of the saints in light. Now, it goes on to say, Paul writes here, he has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light, and he has delivered us from the domain of darkness. He has delivered us. He has rescued us from danger. Okay? And in this particular case, Paul makes no bones about it. It is the domain of darkness. Now, again, most of us don't see ourselves before we were in Christ as on the path or even living in that moment in a domain of darkness per se. Some people do. Some people understand when they're into Satanism or something like that. There might be power involved in that kind of a thing, but there's an understanding that they're standing opposed to the light. There's something in people in that circumstance. But for most of us who maybe never went so far in our outside of Christness, we didn't think of ourselves as being in the domain of darkness, but we were. And if you're outside of Christ today, you are. Currently, right now, sitting here listening. But Jesus has come to deliver us from this, to deliver us and to save us from the domain of darkness. The problem with not recognizing that you're part of the domain of darkness is that you don't see what's coming before it comes. The devil doesn't play fair. Jesus has the class and courtesy to warn us of what the devil will not. You know, even when the devil was trying to tempt Jesus himself, bow down and worship me and I'll give you all this. Sounds good. Sounds like an easy road, but don't think it's free. That would have cost not only Jesus, that would have cost us, those whom Jesus loves. Jesus says, look, if you're going to come follow me, it means leaving things behind. It means saying goodbye to stuff. It means even dividing families. Jesus has the courtesy to tell us that ahead of time. Satan will dangle a carrot in front of you on the end of a stick that you'll never reach. And he will make it seem as though there's nothing but good things coming. Why? Because he's a liar and a cheater and a destroyer. And he seeks to steal, kill, and destroy all that is good. But Jesus has delivered us from such a domain. A domain speaks of authority, somebody who rules over an authority. Now, Satan doesn't rule over hell. Satan is going to suffer in hell just like everybody who chose to follow him and live in that domain of darkness. However, he does carry some certain titles and some clout here on earth, doesn't he? What did Jesus call him? The prince of the power of the air. He has authority here. Why? Because people give it to him. Because people don't surrender their lives to Christ, and instead they walk and they live, whether knowingly or not, in the domain of darkness. There are only, I think C.S. Lewis put it this way, there are only two religions ultimately in the world, God's and Satan's. God's is shown in the face of Jesus Christ, but Satan's has many faces. That's important for us never to be fooled by this. Jesus makes it clear, and he also makes it simple. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father except through me. Now, that may sound narrow, but I'll tell you what, I'm glad there's a way and that it's clear. I might have used this analogy before, but God forbid if this building caught fire. Suppose this building caught fire and the smoke filled this room. We couldn't see a doorway. We couldn't find our way out. And we're just groping all over the floor trying to find some way to find our way out of this. And we couldn't find it. And all of a sudden, a fireman kicks open one of the doors and said, this is the way to safety. Follow me if you want to live. How many of us, even the most completely staunch atheist, how many would say, I think that's a little narrow-minded? I think for you to say this is the only way to safety is a little bit too narrow for my liking. I would like to choose my own way out. Okay, good luck with that. Jesus kicks open the door of eternity and says, you're on a burning building. If you want to get out, this is the way. I am the door. I am the way, the truth, the life. If you want to live, come follow me. Thank you. Yes, please take me. That's what Jesus wants to see in response. He's come to deliver us from this domain of darkness. And not only that, but then to confer us or to transfer us into the kingdom of his beloved Son. The Father has given us not only deliverance from one thing, but he has now, through Christ, put us in another entirely. We have eternity to look forward to, but we also have a relationship with God and freedom in this life to enjoy. Sin pleases for a season, but ultimately it drags us down, it trips us up, it destroys us. But we don't have to walk in that. Why? Because he has brought us out of a domain of darkness into a kingdom of light. We can choose now, because the Holy Spirit lives within believers, to not make the choices that will destroy us, but instead to walk with him. Won't always be easy, won't always be without pain, but it'll keep us free from the destruction that sin will bring. And here's the other thing on top of that as a small, tiny tangent. We sang it today, it's Romans 8:28. He works all things together for good, for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Even when the pain comes, God is using that to build. He prunes because it makes healthy. He tears down that he might build up. He crushes the lump of clay that he might mold something beautiful. If some of you are in a gardening, imagine if a plant that you're pruning could speak. Ow! It's just no one wants an arm cut off or a leaf cut off or whatever kind of thing. But if you don't do that, what happens? The thing will wither up and die. It won't stay healthy. It needs to be pruned so that the nutrients can continue to help this thing to flourish, I think, right? As Adam, not a botanist or anything, but I'm told that's what it works, how it works. But that's why we do these things. Well, God does this in our lives. He will prune things away from time to time so that we might be healthy. It hurts because we don't want to let them go. Sadly, too often, too many things in life that will harm us are like an appendage to us that is hard to remove. But God is very skillful with that scalpel to pull it away, and he's very good to do so. But in the kingdom of light, we can stand in that assurance. We know that God's not messing with us or hurting us on purpose. He's not trying to destroy us. He's trying to give us life and life to the full. The devil, though, not so much. But he's conferred us from this kingdom of the enemy into the kingdom of light. And it just continues to get better and better. In whom we have redemption. Again, in Christ, the Son, the beloved Son, we have redemption, the forgiveness of sin. Now, excuse me, there's that cough drop. He has redeemed us through his shed blood. To be redeemed means to be paid for, to have a ransom paid on your behalf. Picture, if you will, a slave on a slave block who is for sale. And somebody comes and he buys your freedom. I will pay the price for that one, and now you are free to go. You've been redeemed. And you typically, maybe the more accurate picture would be one who was a debtor's slave, somebody who owed a debt to somebody. And this was how they were working it off. And the master then, or someone else, pays that debt, so now you're free. You no longer have to do that. This is where the idea of a bond slave comes from. Once that debt has been paid, if you still wanted to serve that master, you would voluntarily do so, and there'd be some marking or an earring you would take that would mark you as this master's servant, but it would also demonstrate that you had chosen to willingly follow and serve this master because you loved him. And you would love him because he was good to you. Well, God has redeemed us. He has taken us off the slave block. The debt that we owed, which is far greater than any financial debt we could ever owe, Jesus has set us free. He has shed his blood for us. That price has been paid. That's why when Jesus is on the cross, he says, tetelestai. That's a Greek word that means paid in full. Not just it is finished, that's an accurate translation, but it literally means paid in full. A debt has been paid. This is why, and we'll see this later in Colossians chapter 2, where it says the handwriting of the transgressions that was against us was nailed to his cross. It's as if the list of things that you and I demonstrated in our breaking of the law of God was put there on the cross and nailed there, and now we can walk away because it's been paid for. We are free. Knowing these things, and Paul will go on later in the letter to explain this. We'll touch on it as we get there. But it has to go with saying even now, knowing these things, why would you ever want to be a slave to the master of the domain of darkness? Knowing what has been given for you and done for you, why would you ever make the choice to not follow him? And that's what Paul is driving at. He's giving us a clear picture of who Jesus is and what he has done that we might follow him. Now, our debt has been forgiven. That's what the idea of forgiveness is. We have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Now, verse 15 continues, and here's where we begin to get lofty. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. And we'll go on in a moment. He is preeminent over all creation. In this next short passage, section of verses, Paul used the word all 6 times, just in these 3 verses. He starts by saying he is the image of the invisible God. Let's look at that first. He is the image of the invisible God. The word image there speaks of one who is an exact representation. Okay, notice verse 19. We're going to go there later in a moment, but let's look at it first for just a second. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Look at chapter 2. Turn one page over and look at verse 9 of chapter 2. Paul reiterates this idea. Verse 9 of chapter 2, Paul says, for in him, in Christ, the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily. He goes on to speak of how you have been filled and made complete in him, who is the head of all ruler and authority. Verse 19 of chapter 1 speaks to him being the fullness of the Godhead bodily as it relates to our life in him. In terms of being saved by him, in terms of our life in him. Chapter 2, where it speaks about the fullness of God dwelling within Christ, it then has to do with our living for him. In other words, it doesn't just matter that Jesus is God in the flesh theoretically. That means something in terms of salvation and also practically. It matters that Jesus is who he claimed to be and who Paul is putting him out to be. As a matter of fact, you could not make a stronger assertion that Paul's conviction was that Jesus was in fact God than he did in those 2 statements. In him dwells the fullness of God bodily. The fullness, okay? It pleased God that the fullness, his fullness, would dwell in Christ. Now, we spoke to the idea of the Trinity last time a little bit. And I say a little bit because there's an ocean that could be said about the Trinity, and they can't do that kind of thing in an hour. But we spoke about the Trinity as we have to admit is the concept of the Trinity is beyond our minds to fully understand. I'm okay with that. Not because I like not understanding things or because I believe the Christian life is some kind of a leap of faith. I probably mentioned last time that by the time you have to take a step of faith, it is after you have followed a long trail of evidence that has made that step of faith exceptionally reasonable. There is no leaping of faith. But there are some things in the Christian faith that do need to be accepted by faith. One of those is how God's nature is. The word Trinity does not appear in the Bible. Whoop-de-doo. The concept of the Trinity is replete throughout Scripture. You can't get past chapter 1, verse 26 of Genesis before you start seeing hints of the Trinity. The fact that we don't understand it isn't really the point. The fact that God has revealed his nature as such is the point. Whether or not I understand it is a very secondary, a distant secondary thing. Try to explain the fact that you are human, but yet you have an eternal spirit to an ant. Good luck with that. Well, the distance between our minds and an ant's mind is not quite as far as the distance between our mind and God's mind. We're a lot closer to the ant than God is to us. So to say that we don't understand it, therefore we can't believe it. Also, there's a lot of things in life we don't understand, but we still live that way. We still live as if we did. An atom, for example. No one knows why the like charges of an atom don't fling apart like they do in every other example in nature. I mean, there's theories and ideas, but there are exceptions, apparently, to every other rule in nature in this regard. But I'm pretty sure none of us walk around the world expecting it to fling apart at any second. We kind of live our lives knowing that atoms are just going to hold together because it's what they do. We don't understand why, but they do. I think it's because, as the author of Hebrews says, Jesus is holding it together with the word of his power. I think at the end, when the whole universe burns up in a fervent heat, I think he just lets go. There you go. Do what I created you to do. And I think it's going to be the greatest light show in history. So we don't have to understand something to accept it. Okay? I don't understand the mechanics of the Trinity, but I have no doubt that God has revealed himself in this way throughout Scripture. We don't rely on one verse for such a thing. You build a comprehensive theology based on the whole of the Word of God, and that is where we come to. So when it comes to Jesus now being the fullness of the Godhead bodily, I say all that to say this. Don't be stumbled by the way that things are expressed as we try and read them and understand them, because when you're talking about something that is infinite, or someone who is infinite, like Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you're limited by the kind of terminology you can use to express such ideas. And so the fullness of the Godhead bodily dwelling in Jesus doesn't mean that Jesus was some kind of a vessel that gets filled with God and then can somehow be unfilled with God kind of a thing. That's some cults hold a view like that. Some religions through history have held views like that. That the Christ came upon this person, Jesus, at the cross, or up to the cross, and then left him at the cross. And no, that's not true at all. Jesus is fully God and fully man. He is unique in that way. There's no one like him. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, again, unique in all of creation. There's nothing like him. He is other from his creation. But he's the image of the invisible God. This is why Jesus could say to Philip in John chapter 14, when Philip said, "Show us the Father, and it's sufficient," and Jesus said, "Have I been with you for this long, and you're still asking me questions like this? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." Okay? Not just, I just simply do what God would have me do. If you're looking at me, you are looking at God. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Hebrews chapter 1. Let's turn to the right, just a few books. Well, more than a few, but you'll get through Thessalonians, the pastoral epistles, this great little book of Philemon, and then Hebrews. In Hebrews chapter 1, notice what the author says. I'm getting good at not saying Paul, because we don't really know if Paul wrote this or not. But the author of Hebrews starts his letter by saying, "Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son," or in Son, literally, "whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature." And as we spoke earlier, "and he upholds the universe by the word of his power." He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. Okay? When Paul speaks about in Colossians and elsewhere about how the fullness of God is dwelling in Christ, and when the author of Hebrews and other writers in the Scriptures begin to speak about Jesus in such lofty terms, it's important that we understand that there is no separation in his nature. He is both man and God fully in both respects. He's not half and half. He is fully both. There is a man who sits on the throne of God today at the right hand of the Father. Okay? It is important for us to understand that. Jesus did not cease to be a person after he left this earth. Now, he was the eternal Word prior to his incarnation. He didn't have a body like you and I did prior to that, but there was that moment in history where he came into time and he became this fragile, frail, approachable, vulnerable little child in Bethlehem. At that moment, God actually took on a body of flesh for the purpose of dying for our sins. Okay? There's no separation. He didn't stop being God or become God at age 12 or something like that. The angels looked at this in wonder at such a thing as God with us. Now, it goes on then to say he's not only the image of the invisible God, but he's the firstborn of all creation. Now, again, I've built up a lot of that to get to this point, too, because, again, there are religious groups and sects and cults and such that will look at a verse like this and will say, well, see, he's the first created thing. As a matter of fact, in order to push that point, the Jehovah's Witnesses in particular will actually insert words in their version of the Bible in this place to make it to kind of further emphasize the idea that he's a created being. As a matter of fact, their version of this would say, in verse 16 going on, it would say, for by him all other things were created, in heaven and on earth and invisible, whether thrones, dominions, or rulers, all other things were created through him and for him. The idea being that he's the first created being and then everything else is created by him afterward. The fullness of the Godhead dwelling within him, it's not fullness if it does not include eternality. God is everlasting. He is everlasting. To say that somehow that element of God's fullness is not dwelling in Jesus is what is necessary to say that he's not fully God. Everything that God is dwells in Jesus. So to say that he is somehow a created being who then went on to create everything else is a misunderstanding of biblical theology. He is God. John in John 1:1 says this, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by him, and nothing was made except that which was made by him. He is the creator of all things. All things. And you can't even have the word all there unless it means all. Okay? In other words, not all other things, all things were created by him. In other words, he's not a created thing. He created all things. It's important that we understand that, because if we don't understand that, then we believe Jesus had a beginning, whether or not in this world, but somewhere in eternity past, he came into existence. The Mormons hold a view similar to that, where they believe that Jesus and Satan, both being created beings, they're half right in that regard. One of them was created by the other. But if we believe that Jesus had a beginning, that does no longer allow him then to be God, which then means he no longer has the capacity to pay for our sins. There's a lot that that's connected with this. These sound like heady theological ideas, but it's important for us to understand that you must think through the implications of your theology, because when you don't, you start tripping over things. So sorry, I don't mean to get all heady or anything, but it's important for us to put these things together. Now, he is the firstborn over all creation. If it doesn't mean he's the first created thing, what does that mean? The word firstborn, in some instances in Scripture, does in fact mean the first chronologically born person or animal or whatever the context is. However, that same word, prototokos, also speaks of the idea of preeminence or prominence or favored. Okay? It speaks of one who takes the rights of a firstborn, whether or not they're actually a firstborn. One case in particular is in the book of Hebrews. For example, chapter 12, verse 23, speaks about how we are part of the church of the firstborn. The author to Hebrews, later in the same letter we're just looking at, is not speaking of Christ as the firstborn. In other words, we're the church of that firstborn one. No, it is speaking about us as being the firstborns of that church, speaking of our inheritance as a firstborn. So we're not talking about chronological thing now. We're speaking about an inheritance or something that is given to us as a birthright. And that's what's going on here. Paul's not talking about Jesus as being created. He's speaking about him having preeminence over all creation. As the creator of all things, he has preeminence over all of it. He is the Lord of all things. Again, Paul is not diminishing him. He's actually, in fact, elevating him. Now, I'll further that point by saying, look at verse 18, where again it speaks about him being the firstborn over the church. Notice in verse 18, and he is the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. Now, he's not the first one who came back from the dead, is he? There's a couple of instances in Scripture where someone else was brought back from the dead, more than one of whom Jesus brought back from the dead. He brings back from the dead a little girl who had died. He brings back Lazarus. Elijah brings back someone in the Old Testament. There are
there are examples of others coming back from the dead. So we're clearly not talking about somebody who is first in chronology coming back from the dead. And Paul makes that case by saying, so that he might have the preeminence in all things. In other words, he is the first and foremost over all of these things, even including rising from the dead. All of those who will rise from the dead in faith in him are subject to him because he is preeminent even in this. Okay, so we're not talking about chronology. We're talking about preeminence. Now, getting back to our text in verse 16. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, not all other, all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions, rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. All things were created by him. All things. Again, we quoted John 1 just a moment ago. Everything that was made by him. Fascinating, incredible thing to think about. Because normally we talk about creation, we just sort of say God in the generic kind of sense. We speak about God in his fullness. God created the world. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Well, here we're told, both here and also in John, that it is Jesus himself who is active in the work of creation. Of course, the Holy Spirit is also given credit in Scripture. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are all given credit for creation, for redemption, for salvation, for the resurrection, all of these things. But Jesus here is considered, brought out by Paul, as being active even in the creation of all things. Please don't make the mistake, as we often do, of thinking Jesus was somehow just in this place and time confined to some physical body, and that's he was limited in some way. Understand something. The magnitude of his power. When Jesus is on the boat and the storm comes upon it and the disciples are fearing for their lives, Jesus gets up and he tells the weather to stop. And it does. Why? Because he's got really great power and he can do really great things? No, because he's the master of it. Why? Because he created it. It is his to command as its creator. The demons at Gadara coming up there, coming after with the legion filled with, you know, these two men filled with demons. They come up and Jesus gets up, stands before them and says, "What's your name?" All this power inside of these two men, this demonic power that is seething and causing them to writhe. And Jesus just speaks to them and says, "What's your name? Legion, for we're many. Please don't cast us out into the abyss until it's time." They know who the Lord is. Why? Because whatever they originally were, he created them. They're his to command. They're not ultimately under Satan's authority. They're under his. Everything is created by him and under his authority. You cannot express the limitless power of Christ. It's staggering. We should be in awe of such a thought. This is why Paul writes things like this. Not just, okay, well, so we understand we got our ducks in a row. We created all things. Got check. Okay, no. This should bring us to our knees in worship. This should drive us to a point of being undone. The magnificent, awesome presence of Jesus is, it's something for us to celebrate and rejoice, and something for the demons to tremble at. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Wow. This is the Lord we're talking about, and he's our Lord. This is the one whose kingdom we have been transferred into, out of the dominion and the domain of darkness. It says all things were created through him and for him. Not only has he created all things, but these things are created for him. In Revelation, it talks about how we are for his good pleasure. Some people don't like that idea. I don't want to be created for him. I want to do what I want to do. Well, you can choose that road. I think it's a really dumb choice to make because it's going to lead to bad things. It's going to lead to your destruction. It's going to lead ultimately to a dissatisfaction that can't even be measured. And ultimately, it'll lead you to separation from the one that you don't want to belong to. Don't make that choice. You are created for him. That's a blessing. That is beautiful. Some people spend their whole lives trying to find out what their purpose in life is. Why am I here? What is the point of my existence?
You are created for Him and for His good pleasure. You are created to worship Him, to honor Him, to walk with Him, to know Him, to be like Adam and Eve, walking in the cool of the day and enjoying His presence. You are created for such things, such lofty things. Don't sell yourself short for something that pleases for a season. God has promised you so much more than that. He's invited you into something so much greater than that. Verse 17 goes on, and He is before all things. The word "is" there speaks of existing or being. He was in being. He existed before all things. Not all other things, all things. Okay? Nothing existed prior to His existence. Okay? Put it that way. This again speaks to His eternality. Sometimes we don't think about it in these terms, but God doesn't actually need us. Like, He didn't create us because He was lonely. Okay? He didn't create us because He needed something to do. God was fully self-sufficient in all of eternity past, even in the communal sense. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the first example of community in all of eternity is found in the Trinity. Okay? So we were not created for some need on God's part, except His desire to express love. But I wouldn't call that a need. That's love. It's just simply what He wants to do. But Jesus existed before anything else in all of eternity, before there even was an eternity. Eternity speaks of time, before time existed. How many of you saw the movie Interstellar? A couple of you did. That's a great mind bender. But the idea of time being relative. At one point, they're going to a planet to find an inhabitable place, but it's close to a black hole, which means that the longer they stay there, the more time back on Earth is passed, because gravity affects everything, including time. And so time is relative. And so this whole thing is playing. And so they're there for an hour, and it ends up being 23 years in the life, even on the spaceship that they're on, that they're part of, just outside of. It's a really fascinating thing. Well, time is something that's created. It's created. The seconds that are passing, you can't even say it the right way. There was a time in which that didn't exist. Wow. It's awesome. Well, Jesus existed then. Then's not even the right word. Then implies time. There's no terms. There probably are terms to talk about this, but I don't even know what they are. But He existed before anything. Nothing existed before He did. Okay? He's before all things, and that literally means every kind of thing. And in Him, all things hold together. In Him, all things hold together. From the atoms of your body to time and its movement to eternity, everything, even your circumstances. He is literally in charge of everything that is. All things hold together through Him. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything He might be preeminent. Naturally, He is the head of the body. This is the God we worship. This is the one we follow. It stands to reason, then, that He ought to be the head of the body of Christ. Okay? The body is subject to the head. I think there's an amount of time where we could cut our head off and our body might still flail around. Chickens, I think, will run around, hence the expression, chicken with your head cut off. But you can't really function without the head. I mean, there are muscle responses that continue until you eventually die, but there's nothing telling the body what to do. Now, we often think, even like this, I'm not thinking about doing this. My brain is just telling my body to do stuff as I express things. Without the brain, there is none of that. Without the head, there's nothing. You can't see where you're going. You can't hear what people are telling you. You can't think about stuff. You can't decide things. You can't make plans. Nothing. The church has the propensity to run around like a chicken with its head cut off, because we don't connect ourselves to the one who's the head of the body. Christ is the head of the church, and rightly so. He's the one who sees everything, who's in charge of everything. He's above everything. It stands to reason then that we would submit ourselves to Him and let Him be the Lord over every decision, everything that He wants to do in our lives. He died for me, I'll live for Him. That's how it works. He's the head of the church. He's the Lord. He's the one we surrender to. You don't come to church to hear what I'm telling you to do. You notice there's very little of what I actually tell you to do that comes in these sermons. And that's intentional, by the way.
I don't come up here and tell you how to be a Christian. I tell you what the Bible says about how to be a Christian, but I don't tell you whether you should or should not do something, unless it's overt in Scripture. But when it comes to your personal convictions, that's not my job. Why? Because you already have a head. Okay, my job is to tell you about him, that you'll surrender to him and follow him. And also because I don't want the responsibility for all the goofy things that you'd end up doing if you actually listen to what I said to do. It's a side thing, but it's true. But we have the head of the church is Christ. He's the one we ought to be connecting ourselves with, listening to, allowing him to guide our bodies, allowing him to choose what of this is done. He's the Lord. He's the master. He's the body. He's the head of the body. He's the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. Again, verse 19, for him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 for just a moment, and we'll bring this to a close. Turn left just a few books. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. There's one verse out of this passage that we quote often, and is probably familiar, but I'd like to read just a couple of verses prior to, around it, I should say. Verses 17 through 19 is what I'd like to read. Verse 17 is a verse you've no doubt heard me quote here. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. All who come to Christ are new in him. Okay? This is the point. He made us new in him because he was reconciling us to him. The idea of reconciling means setting a ledger straight. Okay? If you reconcile your checkbook or you're in charge of finances in a company or something like that, balance sheets need to balance. Okay? And when they don't, there's a problem. Jesus reconciled our balance sheet for us. He set things right. The far greater debt than we owed, he came in and he filled that gap. He reconciled us to himself, okay? We owed him a tremendous debt. He paid it, okay? And therefore, if we will submit to that, we're new in him. Reconciliation is not just simply so that some number in heaven might be reconciled. It's for a far greater purpose, personally. It's that we might be right with him. It's that we might be reconciled to him, that our ledger might be balanced, that we might have no qualms, no issues anymore. There's no longer an inequity. Everything's been covered over. Everything's been done. It's been paid. It's finished. Guys, I mean, I sound like I'm saying something so simple and I'm beating it to death, but do you understand what Jesus has done and who he is that was able to do such a thing? Please don't ever allow your Christian walk to become something so rote as simply, I've got my facts and figures in a row. Those things are important, but they lead to something. There's a relationship at the end of that journey that is the whole point of the journey. Yeah, we like to say, and I like to travel. Anybody who likes to travel probably has either heard or embraced the idea that really the joy is in the journey. Well, for the Christian, that's not entirely true. There is joy in the journey, no doubt. But the point of the journey is not to just enjoy the journey, okay? When you're traveling, you like to get lost in some side street. You like to sort of find some new thing that was off the beaten path, some little treasure that gives you a story to tell. That's awesome. That's wonderful. But in the Christian life, there's that plus. The point of the Christian life is not just that you enjoy the journey, but it's that the journey leads you to a destination where there is nothing but joy. There's a reason for this, and it's found in a person, the person of Jesus Christ. I think it was Robbie Zacharias that once said that there is a key to the meaning of life found in relationships, and it's true. It's true. I mean, which one of us don't love our children to the point we'd give anything for them? Which one of us can't think upon some friendship in life that meant everything to us? Was it because there was something special about the way the person looked or dressed or they had a cool car, whatever? If that's all it was, they probably aren't the first person you thought of when I started talking about this. There's somebody whose relationship in your life was so meaningful and so
pertinent to who you are as a person, even maybe put something into you that made you who you are today. I think God has built that into relationships on purpose because it's an echo of the relationship that he calls us to with him. It's not just knowing about him. It's knowing him. We say this all the time, and I'll close with this thought. We study the Word of God that we might know the God of the Word. That's the end game. That's what he wants. And my hope is that that's what we want as well. Father, we thank you for your Word. We thank you that you've called us, Lord, by name and invited us to enjoy a relationship with you. And Lord, in spite of the fact that sin has gotten in the way of that, in spite of the fact that the debt that we owed produced a barrier between you and us, or more rightly, between us and you, in spite of these things, you made a way that that debt might be paid and that we might be free, not only to escape hell, but to enjoy eternity with you. Father, I pray that none of us would settle for anything less than an actual and deep relationship with you. That wouldn't allow our Christian life to simply be about knowing some facts, as important as that is. But that would just be the beginning as we seek to know you with whom we have to do. And Father, if there's anyone in our midst here today who doesn't know you, whose sin still creates a barrier between them and you, we thank you that you've given us good news, that you so love them that you sent your only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. If that's you this morning, and you understand that you need to be saved from your sin, that you need to enter into a relationship with God in Christ, it does mean leaving the old life behind. It does mean repenting for your sin, which means turning the other direction, walking away from the very sin and the direction that you are walking in. It means possibly even having fractured relationships, as people don't want to walk with Jesus with you. It comes at a cost, but a very insignificant one compared to the cost that was paid for you in Jesus as he died on the cross. But he also rose again to let us know that there's life beyond the grave. There's hope beyond the last breath we take on earth as we look forward to the first breath we'll take in heaven. If you're ready to leave that old life behind, to ask for forgiveness for your sins, and to turn away from them and to follow Jesus, then I want to give you an opportunity to make that choice and to begin that walk even right here. Especially right now as we're about to partake of the Lord's Supper. It's a perfect time for anyone who needs to get right with God. So if that's you, I invite you to repeat after me this prayer. Heavenly Father, I confess to you that I am a sinner. I've broken your law. I've hurt others. I've been selfish, self-seeking. I have sought to go after my own way, forsaking yours. But today, I confess my sin to you and ask you to forgive me. And I also ask that you would give me the strength to follow you all the days of my life. I believe that Jesus died for my sins and that he rose again to show me the hope of eternity, and that he ever lives to lead me to that place. So walk with me and help me to please you for the rest of my days until I see you face to face. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to go ahead and partake of communion. I invite you to take a moment as we begin to sing. Before the Lord. Even those of us that have been walking with the Lord for any length of time still, from time to time, need to confess. We don't become perfect, as you might have noticed. So we want to take these opportunities to confess before the Lord, allow that relationship to be fully restored. And then as you feel ready, go ahead and come up and get the bread and the cup. Bring it back to your seat, and you can go ahead and partake of that as you will, as you feel ready to do that. I do not deserve the grace that you have given, or the promise of your word. Lord, I stand and wonder the sacrifice you made, with mercy beyond measure. My debt you freely paid. 'Cause your love is deeper than any ocean. Beyond the stars in the sky, Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds.
Love is all we ever need. Love is all we ever need. 'Cause your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. deep, your love is high, love is great, your love is wide, your love is all we ever need, your love is all we ever need, your love is deep, your love is high, your love is great, your love is wide, your love is all we ever need, your love is all we ever need. Your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds.
We stand and sing a song together.
Separate, even if I ran away, 'cause your love never fails. I know that I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day, and your love never fails. Stand the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. When the strong and the waters deep, I'm not alone here in these open seas, 'cause your love never fails. The chasm is far too wide, never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. When the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. 'Cause you make all things work together for my good. Yes, you make all things work together for my good. Yes, you make all things work together for my good. Yes, you make all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the ocean rains, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me more than ever fails. As you make all things work together for my good.
Thank you for that promise, that knowledge, Lord. Pray that we'd walk in it, understanding that we're in your hands as your children, and we have a lot to look forward to both in this life and the next. So help that to change us in the way we see things. Help us to walk with you with these things in mind and in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great week.
Always. You don't want to